This video about tides is motivated in part by former talk show host Bill O'Reilly. Back in 2011, during an interview with the president of American Atheists, O'Reilly said, "Tide goes in, tide goes out, you can't explain it." Well, Bill, I accept your challenge. There is a common misconception that high tide is caused by the moon's gravity raising the ocean on the side of the Earth facing the moon. But if this were the case, then there would only be one high tide per day as the Earth rotates. Note that in this diagram, we are taking the unusual perspective of looking down on the Earth from over the North Pole. But in reality, there are two high tides per day, not one. There is a second tidal bulge on the other side of the Earth facing away from the moon. To understand why this is, we need to consider more than just the force of gravity. You may not recognize him without his wheelchair, but this is physicist Stephen Hawking back in 2007. He's a passenger on a modified Boeing 727, nicknamed the Vomit Comet, for its propensity to induce nausea. The plane is in a dive that simulates freefall. For about 30 seconds, everyone on board experiences weightlessness. Why does this occur? The force of gravity is still pulling down on Stephen Hawking. But because the plane is in free fall, it's accelerating, and the acceleration produces a force that is equal and opposite to the force of gravity. You may recall from high school physics class the concept of force vectors. Each arrow represents a force's direction and magnitude. If you have two forces acting on an object, you can add them graphically like this to find the total force. If we use this technique to find the forces acting on Stephen Hawking, they sum to zero, which is why he's experiencing weightlessness. If you are Canadian, you probably recognize astronaut Chris Hadfield. He's in orbit aboard the International Space Station. And just like Stephen Hawking, Chris Hadfield is also weightless. It is another common misconception that astronauts in orbit are weightless because of their distance from Earth. But the International Space Station is only 400 kilometers above the Earth's surface. At that distance, the force of gravity is still 90% as strong as on the ground. The real reason for weightlessness is that the force of gravity is being canceled by the equal but opposite force of acceleration. This is because any object in orbit is actually in a state of perpetual free fall. It is not obvious that objects in orbit are actually in free fall. It took the genius of Isaac Newton to realize this over 300 years ago. Newton imagined the following thought experiment. Suppose you took the Earth and suspended a cannonball at some height. When you drop the cannonball, it's in free fall until it hits the Earth. In this thought experiment, imagine that the Earth has no atmosphere, so that there is no air resistance to interfere. Now, instead of dropping the cannonball, let's fire it from an enormous cannon. The cannonball will be in free fall for much longer because of the curvature of the Earth. If we increase the power of the cannonball will be in free fall for an increasingly longer period of time. Eventually, if we fire the cannonball fast enough, it will attain a state of perpetual free fall where it never hits the Earth. So both Stephen Hawking and Chris Hadfield are weightless for the exact same reason. They are both in free fall with the force of gravity balanced by the force of acceleration. Before the topic of tides, I need to correct a misconception about orbits. We generally say that the moon orbits the Earth, but it would be more accurate to say that the moon and Earth orbit each other. Let me explain. First, let's consider two objects of equal mass. Let's say we have two identical Earths. Hypothetically, if these two planets were in orbit around each other, they would both follow the same path. They would be in orbit around their common center of mass, which astronomers call the barycenter. Next, let's consider two objects of unequal mass, like the Earth and Mars. Hypothetically, if these two planets were in orbit around each other, they would follow different paths. They would again be in orbit around their common center of mass, which is close to the Earth, since it is more massive than Mars. And finally, let's consider the Earth and Moon and how they actually orbit each other. Here too, the two objects are orbiting their common center of mass. The center of mass happens to be beneath the surface of the Earth, but that does not change the fact that the Earth and the Moon are in orbit around each other. So the Moon is in free fall toward the Earth, and the Earth is in free fall toward the Moon. And since the Earth is in free fall, the force of Moon's gravity is being canceled by the force of Earth's acceleration. But if the forces cancel, why do we have tides at all? If you are located at the very center of the Earth, the force of Moon's gravity and the force of Earth's acceleration will cancel each other out. But if you're located anywhere else, the two forces will not cancel completely. For example, at the surface of the Earth nearest the Moon, the Moon's gravity is stronger than it is at the center of the Earth because the distance to the Moon is less. But the force of Earth's acceleration has the same magnitude and direction no matter where you are located on Earth. So when we add the two forces, the total force points away from the surface of the Earth. Now let's consider the location on the opposite side of the Earth, furthest from the Moon. Here the Moon's gravity is weaker than it is at the center of the Earth, because the distance to the Moon is greater. When we add the force of acceleration, the force again points away from the surface of the Earth. If we repeat this for a few other locations on the Earth's surface, we see the direction and magnitude of the tidal force. This nicely explains why we have two tidal bulges located toward and away from the Moon. The Earth's rotation generates two high tides per day. Bill O'Reilly has been waiting patiently for 9 years, and now finally he has an explanation for how the tide goes in and the tide goes out. Thanks for watching.